all of the work that we've been doing with linear systems and matrices is going to pay off, going well beyond what we've seen thus far. Let's begin taking a look at second order differential equations. And by that, I mean specifically a second order autonomous ordinary differential equation. Such an equation on a function x of t is the following: a times the second derivative of x with respect to t, plus b times the first derivative of x with respect to t, plus c times x equals 0. Here, a, b, and c are constants, and we say that this is a linear second-order autonomous ODE. Because of that linearity, we can interpret everything in terms of the differentiation operator d. So what I can do is write this in terms of a linear operator of the form ad squared plus bd plus c times I, the identity operator, apply that polynomial operator to x, and you have to get 0. That operator equation is really the same thing as the second order linear equation. Okay, now you've probably seen these before in a different course, and you may have learn the solution to these. The solution to such second-order equations is a linear combination of two basis solutions. So the solution of this, x of t, is going to be of the form c1 times phi1 of t plus c2 times phi2 of t, where phi1 and phi2 are these basis solutions that I'm talking about, and c1 and c2 are constants. These are constants that depend on the initial conditions, let's say. Now, what's the deal with these basis solutions? Well, these depend on something called the characteristic equation. The characteristic equation for this second order linear ODE is a lambda squared plus b lambda plus c equals 0. And everything depends on the roots of this characteristic equation. Now you're probably thinking, wow, why are you using lambdas here? Stay tuned. Okay, so we care about the roots of this. And the first possibility, of course, is that you have real distinct roots, lambda 1 and lambda 2, real and different. In this case, the basis solutions are phi 1 is e to the lambda 1 t, and phi 2 is e to the lambda 2 t. Ah, that looks familiar. The second case is if you have real repeated roots, lambda and lambda. In this case, the basis solutions are e to the lambda t and t times e to the lambda t. And in the third case, where you have complex conjugate roots, alpha plus or minus I times beta, then your basis solutions are e to the alpha t cosine beta t and e to the alpha t sine beta t. And we all know by now that really, this is Euler's formula coming out here. This is really the exponentiation of these complex eigenvalues times t. Okay, great. Now, all this is a perspective that one sees often in a differential equations class, most students being left with the question, why? Why is it like this? Why do you have to have these two basis solutions, etc., etc.? Well, one way to explain it is to think in terms of operators. If we look at the operator version of this differential equation, then we have this polynomial differential operator, ad squared plus bd plus c times I applied to x equals 0. Now, what if we could factor that polynomial operator? In this case, it would factor as d minus lambda 1i times d minus lambda 2i. Apply that to x, you get 0, where lambda 1 and lambda 2 are the roots of this characteristic quadratic polynomial. If this is the case, then either the first term annihilates x, or the second term annihilates x. That is, we either have dx equals lambda 1x, or we have dx equals lambda 2x. These are first order equations, and these are really the sources for our basis solutions. Now, I kind of like that. I think that's a helpful perspective, but there's really more to it than this. Really, the best answer for why we have these basis solutions comes from matrix algebra and all the things we've done with first-order linear systems. What we're going to do is we're going to let y be equal to dx dt. This is going to be a new variable, and we're going to pack x and y into a vector. And then look at the first order linear differential equation on this vector x, y. So the derivative of this vector x, y is, of course, dx dt and dy dt. Dx dt is y. Dy dt is really the second derivative of x. We can take our differential equation, solve for the second derivative. We get minus c over a times x minus b over a times y. And voila, this is a linear system. I can pull out the coefficients into a 2x2 matrix, that matrix being 0, 1, negative c over a, negative b over a. That matrix applies to x, y. And now we've got this linear system where our matrix A is this matrix 0, 1, negative c over a, negative b over a, and our vector x with a little underline is really x and y, the derivative of x. Okay, now we know that what really matters is the eigenvalues of A. So with a little bit of work computing the determinant of A minus lambda times I, setting that equal to 0, guess what we get? We get, of course, A lambda squared plus B lambda plus C. Set that equal to 0, solve for lambda, there we go. The full solution to this matrix system, assuming that we have distinct eigenvalues, lambda 1 and lambda 2, is going to be the following. X and y is going to be e to the at applied to the initial condition x naught, y naught. Now, what's the exponential of a times t? Of course, we take the matrix whose columns are v1 and v2, the two corresponding eigenvectors to lambda 1 and lambda 2, times the exponentiated diagonal matrix, that's e to the lambda 1t, 0, 0, e to the lambda 2t, and then I take that matrix of eigenvectors, and I take the inverse of that, all that multiplied together and then applied to the vector of initial conditions x naught and y naught. Now that's a big mess, and really, we only need the first entry, x of t, that's the solution that we care about. So if I take this vector equation and just read off the first row, what do I get? Well, there's a whole bunch of algebra that goes on. And in the end, you're going to get some constant times e to the lambda 1t plus some other constant times e to the lambda 2t. This is the linear combination of basis solutions. Now, these constants out front, well, they depend on the initial conditions, x naught and y naught. They depend on the particulars of the eigenvectors that you have chosen. But in the end, this all matches up the perspective of basis solutions. Now, I don't know. What is this? Are you confused? Is this kind of a mess? Look, it's okay. There are a couple of principles. The first is that the basis solution approach to linear differential equations, that's nice. It's friendly. There's a reason why this is the way you're taught when you first see these sorts of equations. It's really nice to work with that. But linear algebra is, in contrast, hard and awesome. Your goal should be to merge these perspectives together so that you have the understanding that comes with linear algebra, but the intuition and the ease of computation that comes from working with basis solutions.